Beloved, on this most holy night, when our Savior Jesus Christ passed from death to life, we gather with all the church throughout the world in vigil and prayer. This is the Passover of Jesus the Christ. Through light, word, and water, we celebrate the new life that Christ longs for us to have. Let us pray. Redeeming God, source of all life and light, bless this new fire. May we be warmed by the celebration of this Easter feast to share in the everlasting festival of your boundless love through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. May the light of Christ, rising in glory, illumine our hearts and minds. Rejoice, all creation. Let heavenly choruses sing. Jesus Christ, our light, is risen. Sound the trumpet of salvation. Rejoice, O earth, in shining splendor. The light of Christ will warm our night. Christ has conquered. Glory fills you. Darkness will vanish forever. Rejoice, O people of God. Give glory. The risen Savior shines upon you. Let this place resound with joy, echoing the mighty song of all God's people. The Lord is here. God's Spirit is within us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to God. It is right to offer thanks and praise. It is truly right that with full hearts and minds and voices we should praise you, the eternal God, and your firstborn, our Savior Jesus Christ. For Christ is the true Passover Lamb who has set your faithful people free. This is the night when you saved the people of Israel from their slavery in Egypt and led them through the Red Sea on dry land. This is the night when a pillar of fire brought light to your wandering people. This is the night when all who believe in Christ are delivered from gloom and are restored to grace and grow together in fullness of life. This is the night when Jesus broke the chains of death and rose triumphant from the grave. This is the night. Night truly blessed, when heaven is joined to earth and we are reconciled with God. Therefore, holy God, in the joy of this night, accept our praise as your people's offering. Accept our Easter candles, flames that are divided but undimmed. A pillar of fire that grows to honor you, O God. Let it mingle with the lights of heaven and continue burning to lighten the darkness of night. May the morning star find this flame still burning among us. Christ is that morning star who rises to shed your peace and light over all creation. Christ is now alive and glorified with you forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Jesus is risen.
Alleluia, Jesus is risen.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Alleluia, Jesus is risen.
Alleluia.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Jesus is risen.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Jesus is risen.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen. Alleluia.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in a well-watered garden. In the desert you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your gift of salvation through water, for the water from the baptismal font, and for all water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty and give us life that only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, both now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Israel with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear. Not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
The second reading is from Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4. If you've been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Here ends the reading.
Greetings from Alabama. The gospel comes from the 28th chapter of Matthew. After the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. 'Greetings,' he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.' The Gospel of the Lord.
Grace and peace from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. This Holy Week, I have been thinking about a woman from a former parish that I served. Her name was Jennifer. That's not really her name, but that's what we're going to call her for the purposes of this story. She came to my office one time, and she struck up a casual conversation. We talked about this thing and the other, and the conversation kind of dragged on for a while, and I was starting to notice that, you know, maybe there was something else going on for her. But she didn't bring it up, so I wasn't going to. And as she turned to leave, she said, "Pastor, there's just one more thing." And I've been doing this long enough to figure out that when somebody tells you there's just one more thing, that usually that's the meat of the conversation. That's the part that you want to stand up and take notice of. And so I asked her, I said, "Yeah, what's going on? How are you doing?" And she said, "I'm doing horribly. I've been depressed for a really long time. Things just don't seem right. I'm not myself." And she paused and she looked at me and she said, "Do you sometimes think that all of this is just a hoax? It's an illusion? It's a myth?" And I answered her, probably unexpectedly. And I said, "Yeah, sometimes I do." She continued, "I don't know. I've had so many friends who've been hurt lately. Friends who have cancer. Whose husbands have had strokes. Friends whose kids are going through divorces. I just don't understand how a God of love would allow my friends to hurt so deeply." We continued our conversation for a little while. And then she said, "You know, when somebody gets hurt, it's like I feel their pain. When somebody cuts their finger, it's like I cut my own finger. If somebody has cancer, it's like I have cancer. If someone's husband has a stroke, it's like my husband had a stroke. I feel their feelings so deeply, and sometimes I wonder if there's something wrong with me." My response to her was, "You really identify with your friends, don't you?" And she said, "Yeah, it's really hard to believe in God at times like this, isn't it? It seems like a hoax about God and heaven and about God's presence being with us, about God intervening in life situations. It all seems like a hoax." There was a long pause, and then she blurted out, kind of quietly, "I remember when my child was born. He was blind. And I remember how much I cried in the hospital. I remember how hard it was for me to gradually open up and accept what had happened. And during that week, I just cried. During the weekend, I went home, and underneath it all, I knew that God was going to be with me, was already with me, that God was going to give me the strength. So when I finally got home, I thank God for giving me such a good baby. I thank God for giving me such a good husband. I thank God for being with me. And I knew that I could handle all of this with God's presence. And then I broke down and I cried again." We talked more like this back and forth for a while. And it was time and we said goodbye and we hugged. And we were aware. We were aware that God had been with us. That God had been with us in this conversation. And both of us had experienced, in some small measure, this healing presence of God. And as I think about that story, I think about the God that I know. The God who has some skin in the game. The God who, while I do not believe, has ever planned for ill or disease or pandemic, can transform our losses into gains. In the Easter story, in the Holy Week story, we, in the course of 4 days, see that Jesus has gone from being a coronated king to being a captured criminal. The fickle nature of once faithful followers should serve as a constant reminder to us to not give up when all hope seems lost. For the lesson of Easter is that what appears to be our greatest failure may actually be a new beginning. This Easter message is a needed reminder in our world today. There are so many ways that we are dealing and things that we are dealing with, and they could easily be called prolonged trauma. And you are likely doing better than you give yourself credit for. And as time goes by, we will have some hard work to engage personally and communally as we try to process everything that has happened. But Brené Brown is so good to remind us of these very things that Jesus' life has taught us as we begin that work. Vulnerability is the birthplace of love, of belonging, joy, courage, empathy, and creativity. It is the source of hope, empathy, accountability, and authenticity. If we want greater clarity in our purpose or deeper and more meaningful spiritual lives, vulnerability is the path. And nothing in our life has made us more vulnerable than this. This is why I believe that for the church to continue to be the church, to be the force of what is good and decent in this world, it may have to tell the truth about itself, to be vulnerable, to apologize for not standing up for the very people Jesus sought to save, to look at the proverbial crosses to the right and left of Christ and notice who is being hanged on a tree and to say, stop. To really look and see the disparities of class and color and healthcare. We see the injustice that this pandemic has peeled back the curtain on, and we can offer salvation here and now. Evil settles into everyday life when people are unwilling or unable to recognize it. It makes its home among us when we are keen to minimize it or describe it as something else. If anything is able to call out evil, it should be the church. If you want to make a difference, the next time you see someone being cruel to another human being, take it personally. Take it personally because it is personal. Be like Jennifer, who cannot help but feel the pain of her friends and neighbors. And when you cannot fathom a God who would allow these things to happen, remember that in our baptism and in our communion that we receive, we become what we receive. We become what we receive, the living, breathing body of Christ. And where you can offer salvation to someone, do it. If anybody ever told you that the life of a Christian was easy, they obviously didn't read the book to the end. Ours is not a faith that is meant to inoculate us or numb us from the pain of life. We are not here just biding time until our appointment at the pearly gates. Jesus meant for us to have some skin in the game too. Following Christ just might be risky business in the face of a world that still operates like a power-hungry empire. But because Christ has shown us the way, we already have the roadmap for the days ahead. And right now, friends, it is time to follow it. Amen.
Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of resurrection, From the very beginning, you give the church the gift of women as your witnesses, as preachers, teachers, and leaders. Open our ears to their proclamation this day and always. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All your creation praises you. The earth hums, the seas pulse, the stars shine, and the galaxies whirl in glorious harmonies to honor you. Let our voices be filled with praise and gratitude, and may our actions honor the earth you have created. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The countries of the world experience disunity and conflict. We set our minds on fear and greed rather than on your rule of justice and steadfast love. Build up all countries on your cornerstone of peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We still weep with those who weep and mourn with those who mourn. Cradle the fearful, the suffering, and the dying, assuring them of your loving presence, especially those who must die alone, those who are suffering from COVID-19, and all who work in healthcare. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Risen Lord, you went ahead of us into the grave and defeated the powers of evil. We remember those who have died. Inspire us to live our lives in this resurrection hope and draw us to you in our final days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Merciful God, our ordinary gifts seem small for such a celebration, but you make of them an abundance, just as you do with our lives. We look forward to when we can be fed at your table and encouraged for service in your name. In the strength of the risen Christ. Amen.
Please join in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
One of the things that I struggle with myself sometimes is when I'm trying to find that moment to speak to God, to open my heart and say the words that I need to say or that I want to say. Sometimes there are so many words that it's hard to pinpoint what it is, the message that I want to get across. And I think sometimes where I take some solace is in the Lord's Prayer, where it hits every note, it hits every message, it says everything that we need to say without having to go too deep into the words. The problem is sometimes the Lord's Prayer gets generic. We get used to saying the words and the sounds and not hitting the message of it. And sometimes I found that instead of saying it, singing it puts the emphasis back into that prayer. Instead of something that we say as a group and we say the words and we get through it and we move on to the next thing and we miss the meaning in that Lord's Prayer, taking that message and putting it to music and putting it for message behind it, sometimes I think redirects that perfect prayer. So I'll share my version, which is a version of Michael W. Smith's The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and all the power and the glory forever. Amen. For thine is the kingdom and all the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.